which involve Muslim marriage has caused many conflict and disputes that need a special court. Okay, now we are moving on to second speaker, Ibu Dr. Afifah Kusumadara. Ibu Afifah, the time is yours. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for participating. How is my voice?
I can see your voice clearly, crystal clear.
Thank you. All right. So now let me prepare with my presentation and then I will share it with all of you. Just a moment. Okay, everybody, you got it? Could you see? Okay. Okay, if everybody could see it, now let me start. Okay, I also activate my my timer. Just let me know if my voice get disconnected on and off. Perhaps I better to switch off my video. Just let me know, Bu Ranitia. All right. Okay. Now, good afternoon, everybody. Once again, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Okay. So my presentation today is about family law in Indonesian private international law. As we know, the terms, some civil law countries use the term private international law, and common law countries such as Malaysia, I think, use the terms conflict of laws. And then we have to remember that although it is called private international law, but it is not international law in the sense like in the, you know, international agreements, that kind of thing. So the law that govern the matters in private international law is actually the national law of each country, you know, the domestic law of each country, except if that particular country ratifies or accedes to the convention, international conventions on private international law. I think there are several, organization that administer the international conventions on private international law, such as the Hague Conference on Private International Law, that to date, Indonesia, I think also Malaysia, are not a party to this Hague Conference. Then there is also UNIDROA, in which Indonesia is a party to it. Then also UNCITRAL. Then now I move into the issues of family law under Indonesian private international law. So basically, if we are discussing family law under Indonesian private international law, we discuss a broad issues, broad issues, anything that involves foreign elements. For example, you know, family law that involve foreign elements could be mixed marriages, could be divorce, nullity, separation, financial relief, issues about children, inheritance or succession, mental incapacity, and I display here pictures. I think all of us must know. I mean, they are a very famous couples of mixed marriages between Indonesian and Malaysia. As I mentioned in the beginning of this program, that Indonesian and Malaysian actually are family somehow. So this also part of the issues under family law in private international law. All right. Of course, I'm unable to explain all these issues during this very limited time. However, if you want to study further or learn more deeper about Indonesian private international law, I happily tell you to read or buy the book. So this book will be published in March 2021 by the Heart Publishing United Kingdom. So this book, Indonesian Private International Law, is written by the team of Brawijaya law lecturers. Yes, and then it will be published in March 2021 by the Heart Publishing United Kingdom. You may check in their website. Okay, so now let's move. So now we discuss about the marriage issue. Like other legal actions, any legal actions, to be valid legally, any legal actions, including marriage, must meet both formal and substantive requirements. You know, formal requirements such as announcement, witnesses, registration of the marriage, and substantive requirements such as the minimum age to marry, the consent, the permission from the parents or guardians, etc., etc. So to be valid, any spouse or couple must meet both the formal as well as substantive requirements of marriage. So under Indonesian private international law, regarding the formal requirements of marriage, we apply the principle of locus regit actum. Although Dr. Helmi didn't mention it, but I think this principle, locus regit actum, is a universal principle. Almost all private international law in every country applies this principle of locus regit actum. So what does it mean, this principle? It is that the formal requirements or formal validity of a legal action, including marriage, is determined in accordance with the law of the country or a state where that action is performed. So the requirement of registration, announcement, that kind of thing must comply with the law of the country or the place where the marriage is performed. And this principle, locus regit actum, is also adopted by Indonesian Marriage Act 1974. And this principle of locus regit actum also applies to foreigners who marry in Indonesian or within Indonesian territory. So for example, I give you the illustration, such as there is a Malaysian who will get married in Indonesia. So this Malaysian must comply with formal requirements of Indonesian marriage law, formality, okay? Basically by registering his or her marriage to the civil registry office in Indonesia, okay? After obtaining a marriage permit from the Malaysian embassy in Jakarta. So after obtaining the permission from its embassy, then he or she or this Malaysian must register his or her marriage to the civil registry office in Indonesia. This is to comply with the principle of locus regit actum. Then we move on to the substantive requirements of marriage under Indonesian private international law. Basically, if we are talking about substantive requirements or capacity to marriage, such as the minimum age, the permission from the guardian or the parents, things like that. Indonesian private international law applies nationality principle. Nationality principle. What it means that for the substantive requirements to marriage, the law that determines the capacity to marriage of anybody is the national law of that person. This is the meaning of the nationality principle. And Indonesia adopts this principle. So wherever Indonesia gets married, whether he or she gets married in Malaysia, in Australia, in Japan, wherever, the substantive requirements such as the minimum age, you know, that other requirements of substantive requirement must comply with the Indonesian Marriage Act 1974. This is regarding the substantive requirements of marriage. So I give you the illustration here. So to be considered valid under Indonesian law, a marriage of Indonesian couple or a mixed couple between Indonesian and Malaysian in Kuala Lumpur must comply with first the marriage formality in Malaysia, because they got married in Kuala Lumpur. And then secondly, the marriage also must meet the substantive requirements, means must meet the requirements of Marriage Act 1974 to be recognized in Indonesia, okay, to be also valid under Indonesian law. So this is the illustration of the combination of, you know, compliance with both formal requirement as well as substantive requirement. Then after there, the couple return to Indonesia, then the couple or the Indonesian spouse must report their marriage to the civil registry office at the district of their residence in Indonesia within 30 days after their return to Indonesia. So now, what about the nationality of the child of this mixed couple? So based on the Indonesian Citizenship Act 2006, a child born to a mixed couple whose marriage is valid, you know, legally valid under Indonesian law, so the child can have double nationalities or double citizenship until the child turns 18 years old. So after the child turns 18 years old, he or she will lose Indonesian citizenship if he or she denotes other nationalities with the city six. So now we are discussing about the matrimonial property of especially mixed couple. If we are discussing about matrimonial property or property, there are two types of property. Regarding the immovable property, Indonesian private international law applies the principle of lex rei sitae. I think this principle is also once again a universal principle. So if we are discussing about the law of the country where the immovable property is situated,
Ibu Afifa,
will determine the right to that immovable property. Yes?
I'm sorry for interrupt. Sometimes your voice, I can hear clearly. So I suggest how if you turn off your screen.
Okay. Yeah. I also
thank switch. You. I'm sorry.
That's all right. I will also switch other, you know, my the YouTube, so to reduce the bandwidth. Thanks for letting me know. So until when, which is my voice, I mean, you could follow me with slide.
Sorry.
Could I continue? Or it is yours. Your, anyway. Okay, guys. Sorry. Okay, participants, ladies and gentlemen, I will continue my presentation without my video. All right? Okay. Okay. So now I repeat again, matrimonial property of mixed couple means that the couple are Indonesian spouse and foreigner. We talk about immovable property as well as movable property. For immovable property, international law, the meaning is the law of the country where the immovable property is situated will determine the right to the immovable property. So I give you the rule here. So let's say this mixed couple in Indonesia. What law that determine the right to the immovable property in Indonesia? Based on the law where the immovable property situated, which is Indonesian law, Basic Agrarian Act 1960, Article 26, foreign citizens who obtain the rights to land in Indonesia through matrimonial property ownership shall relinquish their rights within a year from acquiring the rights. Otherwise, the state will take the rights or confiscate the rights. So, acquiring the rights and, you know, relinquishing the right. But in practice, Indonesian authorities normally, since the beginning, will prohibit Indonesian citizens who are married to foreigners from purchasing land and buildings in Indonesia to avoid the foreign spouse to have rights to land and building in Indonesia. This is the practice. The exception is for mixed couples who, since before their marriage, they already make prenuptial agreements that separate their property during their marriage. So this is what happened in practice. Regarding the movable property, it could be both tangible and intangible. You know, such as jewelries or bank accounts, you know, movable property. Then Indonesian private international law applies the principle of mobilia secuntur personam. So the law applicable to determine the right to the movable property is the national law of the owner of the property. However, in the draft of the Indonesian Private International Law Bill, that now it is still being drafted by the Ministry of Law and Human Rights in Indonesia, it is suggested that for the future Indonesian Private International Law, even for movable property, we will apply also the principle of lex re cite, like for immovable property. But it is not law yet because it is still in the draft. So for the time being, for movable property that I mentioned before, such as jewelries, bank account, that kind of thing, the applicable principle is mobilia secuntur personam. Now we are talking about the succession to property. So the succession to property applies the principle of the nationality principle. So means what? The law applicable to succession is the national law of the deceased, of the dead. So the law that applicable to succession is the national law of the deceased. I give you the illustration. So an Indonesian mother, let's say, Indonesian citizen, left land and buildings in Bali after her death. And then one of her heirs happens to be a Malaysian citizen. If we apply the nationality principle in accordance with Indonesian private international law, then the national law of the deceased, means the Indonesian law, does not prohibit the Malaysian heir to be her legitimate heir, the legitimate heir, then the Malaysian shall be entitled to the legitima porsi of the estate left by the Indonesian citizen. And this Malaysian cannot be excluded by the other Indonesian heirs. But back to the Basic Agrarian Act again, Indonesian Basic Agrarian Act again, we have to remember that foreign citizens who obtain the rights to land in Indonesia through inheritance shall relinquish their rights within 1 year from inheriting the rights. Otherwise, the state will take the rights. Means that the foreign heirs must sell out the land and buildings in Indonesia within 1 year from inheritance. So now I move to the discussion about the children. Unlike other matters in family law, regarding the children, Indonesian private international law does not apply the nationality principle. Instead, the right of children, according to Indonesian private international law, are governed by the law of their habitual resident. Once again, the law of the children habitual resident, so not by their national law. For example, in the case of maintenance for children. So Professor Sudargo Gautama, a leading scholar in Indonesian private international law, wrote that maintenance obligation in respect of children, regardless of the marital status of the parent and regardless of the nationality of the children, is determined by the law of the habitual residence of the children. And this principle, the law of the habitual residence of the children, is also adopted by the draft of Indonesian private international law bill. Means that any child who lives and or resides in Indonesia, the law that protect them is Indonesian Child Protection Act 2002 as amended in 2014. So this Child Protection Act will govern the parental maintenance obligation for children, regardless of the marital status of the parents, regardless of the nationality of the parents. So the Child Protection Act Indonesia will supersede the national law of the parents. We have to remember that Indonesia is not yet a party to the Hague Convention regarding the family maintenance as well as the child protection. So I give you the illustration here. An Arab man, for example, fathers an illegitimate child in Indonesia. Based on the law of the child's habitual residence in Indonesia, means the Child Protection Act, that Arab man could be ordered to provide maintenance to the child. Although, according to the Arab national law, that Arab man does not have any civil obligation to his illegitimate child. So this is the illustration to describe the application of the child's habitual resident law. Then I'm discuss a very interesting issue, which is wrongful removal of children. So some scholars call this term as, or use the term as, international child abduction. But others prefer to use the term wrongful removal of children. So like Malaysia, Indonesia is not a party to the Hague Convention of International Child Abduction. However, both Malaysia and Indonesia are joining the Malta process. What is the Malta process? I give you a quick introduction, basically Malta process is a way of dialogue involving both contracting states to the Hague Convention concerning family matters or children, you know, a dialogue to find cooperation between contracting states to Hague Convention and non-contracting states whose legal system is based on Sharia or Islamic law, like Indonesia, Malaysia, Morocco, etc. So we do not join the Hague Convention. However, we join the Malta process. And the issue of wrongful removal of children is also not recognized in the current family law in Indonesia. Also, unfortunately, this issue also will not be governed by the draft of Indonesian private international law bill. So I give you, I almost reached my end of presentation, but this is the very interesting issue. So there is a case, and there are increasing cases, you know, about this wrongful removal of the children, because usually when the parents are in dispute, they got divorced, and then they fight for the custody of the children. So one of the cases is Yan Sailan, Indonesian mother, versus Dennis Kellett, Australian father, and they have a child born in Indonesia. So we see here the difference between different approach made by Australian court and made by Indonesian court. So the Australian court basically adjudicated this case based on the Hague Convention on the International Child Abduction, because Australia is a party to that convention. So Dennis, Australian husband, took the couple son, you know, their son, to Australia without the consent of Yan, the Indonesian wife. Then Family Court of Australia in Sydney ordered Dennis to return the child to Indonesia, because Indonesia was deemed as the country of the child's habitual residence. In addition, the court granted the custody of the child to Yan. Then Indonesian court, we move to Indonesian court. We see the different approach. In front of Indonesian court, in this case, in the Jakarta court, Dennis filed a petition for custody of the child. Then the Jakarta court granted the custody to Dennis because the judge considered the mother irresponsible parent, have a hobby of partying, boyfriends, you know, that kind of thing. So when adjudicating the case, the Jakarta court did not discuss at all the issue of child abduction by Dennis, and the court did not consider the child's habitual resident, which was in Jakarta. Just give the custody to Dennis, that's it. Then Yan, the Indonesian mother, appealed to Indonesian Supreme Court. The Indonesian Supreme Court overturned the Jakarta court judgment and reinstated Yan's custody in accordance with the ruling of Australian court. Once again, Indonesian Supreme Court, when made this judgment, only considered the custody issue. So the Supreme Court did not discuss the issue of the child abduction. So I think I'm running out of time. So this is the summary of applicable law for family law. And this is my conclusion. So that's it. Thank you so much for your kind attention. So I return this session to Ibu Moderator, Bu Ranitia. Thank you.
Thank you, Bu Dr. Afifa, for terrific presentation. Sadly, we only have limited time, so maybe we will move to Q&A session. We got, I don't make a conclusion because Bu Afifa already read the conclusion. We are now moving to question and answer session, sorry. We got plenty question from all participants. For each session, I will read two questions for each speaker. First question for Dr. Helmi from Intan Faradiba. The question is, I will read to Dr. Helmi. Dr. Helmi, can you hear my voice?
Yes, I hear you. You. I mm-hmm. just instead answering or just wait for
sorry? Okay. This is question from Intan, student of Brawijaya, Universitas Brawijaya. She asked, in the slide, it is stated that in general jurisdiction for recognition of marriage carried that are solemnized abroad lies with the civil high courts for non-Muslim and with the Sharia court for Muslim. What about the arrangement in Malaysia regarding recognition of marriage between Muslim and non-Muslim? This is the first question. Can you get the point?
Okay, with mm-hmm. may I answer that or you want to?
Okay, which one do you prefer? Actually, I want to ask two questions first and then you answer, or you want to? Okay, is it okay if I
proceed the question first?
Sorry.
Proceed the question first.
The second question from Zafran, he asked, there were several cases that include Indonesian citizens where they prefer to got marriage abroad, commonly to Singapore. That is because the marriage were between Muslim and non-Muslim, and actually it is prohibited in Indonesia and under our legal provision. Is there any such legal provision that allowing foreigner to get married in Malaysia because they couldn't legally married in their home country? The mixed interfaith marriage, I mean, is it Malaysia? Recognize okay. the interfaith marriage. This is the second question.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Radinia. The first question is about the mixed marriage, isn't it?
The second issue is mixed marriage, and the first is
Okay. Mm-hmm. There is my first answer is for the first question is, there is no mixed marriage in Malaysia. Okay, the marriage cannot be solemnized. Okay, we have the law. Okay, that prohibit for Muslim to get married for the non-Muslim. If they want to get married, they have to revert to Muslim. Okay, and for the second question, there is no law. Okay, that allow mixed marriage or any foreigner to get married. Okay, in Malaysia. Okay, Malaysia law doesn't allow any such kind of that marriage.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Helmi. So it is also prohibited to interfaith marriage in Malaysia. So
yeah,
that
correct.
Is the
yeah.
conclusion. Okay. Ibu Afif, Ibu Dr. Afifa, two questions.
Yes.
Addressed to Ibu Afifa. First from Maheswari, our student from Universitas Brawijaya. She asked, regarding the nationality of the child of mixed people, mm-hmm. is it possible that child can become a stateless when the nationality laws of the country clash? How does the perspective under private international law, also if it is possible, how to prevent that happen? So stateless child. Second question from Aditya Rizky Ramahan. What is the common problem that an international couple can get when they wanted to get married in Indonesia, especially regarding the registration of the citizenship based on the international private law that we currently have? And is there any regulation within the procedure that potentially bluff the couple? Maybe like some celebrity, they got married in Bali, is it?
Okay.
The question.
Okay. Okay. All right. So thank you. May I answer?
Yep.
Directly? All right.
Yes.
So it's good questions. Thank you very much. So first to Maheswari. So here in Indonesia, also for my colleagues from Malaysia, as well as Malaysian students. In Indonesian term, we use the term mixed couple to describe, it is always slow, right? My voice is just not. Okay. How is my question? My voice? Sorry. Is it okay? All right, good. So I will explain that I think I better to switch off the other things in my computer. Hold on. I'm sorry, but that is technical problem. Okay. Yes. So for all participants, both from Malaysia and Indonesia, Indonesian law used the term mixed couple to describe a couple between different citizenship. So the couple between different citizenship. So quite often, the non-law background, those who do not have law background, mention mixed couple to describe a couple between different faith, you know, like interfaith couple. Interfaith couple in Indonesia, it is not called mixed couple. Interfaith couple is interfaith couple, while mixed couple is the couple between different nationalities. All right, to answer Maheswari's question, the child, is it possible that the child can become stateless? Well, based on Indonesian citizen law, especially regarding the child, we, the Indonesian government, as much as possible, will protect the child. So, based on Indonesian Citizenship Act, the Indonesian government will give will provide citizenship to that child to avoid the child to become stateless. I mentioned this following the practice, for example, that quite often happens in the border between Malaysia and Indonesia. As we know, there are many Indonesian labor migrants, you know, Indonesian labor who work in Malaysia. And for whatever reason, they don't have legal documents. Okay? So either they produce children without proper legal documents, or they married to other migrant workers whom they met in Malaysia, and the children do not have legal status, neither Malaysian citizen nor Indonesian citizen. But one of the parents is Indonesian citizen. So this often happens. So what the Indonesian government does to help in this issue, because it is Indonesian responsibility, part of the protection of human rights. So they invite these Indonesian labor migrants, you know, in Malaysia, and then they marry them legally because they marry them within the Indonesian embassy. So means all the law regarding marriage, as well as the formal requirement, substantive requirement, will be under Indonesian law because it is within Indonesian embassy. So they give the document, legal document, marriage certificate, etc. So based on that, the child could be recognized as legitimate child and could be given the Indonesian citizenship. So this is the way the Indonesian government tried to protect a child from being stateless. And this often happens in the border between Indonesia and Malaysia. So in either consulates or Indonesian embassy will help tackle the issue. So I hope this answered your question. And regarding the question from Aditya, what is the common problem that international couple, what do you mean international couple here? both of the couple are foreigners, celebrities married in Indonesia, or international couple means Indonesian and Malaysia. I cannot get the question. Perhaps we could return to this question later on, Bu Ranitia. Perhaps he could be asked to write again the question in the chat box. I'm sorry, yeah. I cannot understand this question.
It's okay, Bu Afifa. So please, Mas Aditya, could you please to... What do you mean with international couple? Actually, you can write down the meaning of international couple in the chat box. Maybe I will move to Ibu Afifa, the second question from our students from University Kebangsaan Malaysia, Nur Sufia. She asked, does Indonesia has a separate law in family matters for Muslim and non-Muslim? Okay, thank you.
That's a good question. Yes, we do. Quite similar to Malaysian legal system. For family matters, since 1991, the Indonesian government under Suharto, the late President Suharto, he issued the presidential instruction number 1999 or 1995. Presidential instruction number 1991 that disseminate the compilation of Islamic law. We call it compilation of Islamic law. But I have to tell all of and remind all of us, the compilation of Islamic law cannot be regarded as what you call it, like formal law. Okay, this compilation is issued and drafted to help judges in religious court in Indonesia to deal with the Islamic family matters, because similar to Malaysia, in Indonesian court system, there is for family matters, there are two court system. The district court, which is for general matters, is for the family matters who are the parties are not Muslim, non-Muslim. And then the other court, we call it religious court. We don't use the term Sharia. So we use term religious court. In Indonesian, we call it pengadilan agama. So it is to deal with the disputes of family matters whose the parties are Muslims. So we already have established a civil law code for family matters or for personal matters, but for the district court, for the court for general matters, you know, general jurisdiction. Then the question is that the judges in the religious court quite often ask what we have to do. It is not appropriate, right, to apply the civil code that actually we inherited from the colonial Dutch government. So in 1991, Indonesian president at that time draft order the Islamic scholars in Indonesia to draft what it is called compilation of Islamic law. So basically, compilation of Islamic law is a guidance for judges in religious courts to deal with the family matters that are the parties are Muslims. So this thing, such as divorce, inheritance, children, etc. I hope I could answer your question.
Thank you, Ibu Afifa, for the answers. I will go to the next question for Dr. Helmi. This question from Mbak Intan Nur Aini from Universitas Brawijaya. She asks, it is stated on the slide that if the couple fail to register their marriage, penalties will be imposed to them. But this doesn't mean the marriage cannot be registered. The question is, what kind of penalties that possibly could be imposed to the couple, and is there any special requirement for the failed to register couple for their marriage to be allegedly registered in Malaysia. Thank you.
Okay, for dissension or penalty that the couples that fail to register, okay, according to the section 41 of the Islamic Family Law Act, Federal Territories, 41, mentioned any person, who marries or purports to marry or goes through the form of marriage, any person, contrary to any of the provision, shall be punished with a fine, not exceeding 1,000 ringgit, or with imprisonment not exceeding 6 months. That the date for the punishment or sanction for those couple who fail to register their marriage.
Okay. So
I know it is very the penalty is too relative low. That's why the relevancy, relevancy of the occurrence of the marriage happen, they fail to register. That's why. Okay, that's why one of the initiatives taken by the government, they want to increase the penalties so that the people afraid to get abroad, to get married abroad. Okay.
Thank you for the brief explanation regarding the sanction, Dr. Helmi. The second question, the fourth question from Ida Susanti, Universitas Parahyangan, Bandung. Thank you for joining this program. The question is, you mentioned the existence of British law, Malay customary law, Islamic law, and also in Johor, there is also different law influenced by Ottoman law. Could you please explain further how does Malaysian law deal with that legal pluralism and determine the applicable law of transnational marriage, which the parties have different religions? Does the different religions will affect their marriage validity? Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you for the question. Okay, first of all, I would like to say that this is the only historical development. Okay, before the independence, we have the so many laws, governed by each state. And the first law that I mentioned, that from the Johor, they have taken the Ottoman law, Majalah Al-Ahkam, as their law. However, after the Independence Day, every state, 14 state in Malaysia, we have the 14 each sets of law differently. For example, and each of these states have their own courts, Sharia courts. That's the way they govern, the people. And bear in mind that I mentioned you, very early, of my lecture today, We have two separate laws, First for the Muslim and secondly for non-Muslim. And non-Muslim is governed, is governed by the civil high court. And for the Muslim is governed by the Sharia court. And bear in mind also, for the non-Muslim, let's domicile, is the law, And for the Muslim, we cannot consider the domicile, We before 1984, we used the word domicile. However, in order to depart from the intention of the common law, ruler or the states, use the word residence, in the Bahasa Melayu we use the word maustautin. Before that we used to have the word domicile, but however in 1984 we depart from that meaning. We use the word resident, it's more proper. That's why nationality, like the Dr. Afifah mentioned, that is different, because we in Malaysia, for the Muslim, we consider the essential validity first. Second consideration is the formal validity. It's different, For Malaysia, okay. That's all for me.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Helmi. Bu Afifa, could I continue the next question from Mas Muklis, Universitas Brawijaya. He asked, Mrs. Afifa, the question, how is the legal protection for the status of children of couple who has mixed marriage before and after the enactment of law number 12 of 2006 on citizenship?
Okay, thank you.
You may answer first, yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sorry, thank you. Okay, so before the enactment of the 2006 Citizenship Act, so the Indonesian children born to mixed marriage, okay, born to the mixed marriage, will automatically follow the father's nationality. Okay, will follow. Different from the children born to mixed marriage after 2006, as I mentioned earlier. However, after the enactment of the Citizenship Act 2006, as long as the children born before the Citizenship Act was enacted or was passed, as long as they have not reached 18 years old, then there is a special procedure for these children that were born before the Citizenship Act was passed. There is a special procedure because by law, automatically the children will follow the father's nationality automatically. Okay, but they are given a special procedure as long as they have not reached 18 years old to register and to apply for Indonesian citizenship. Okay, and then if they comply with this special regulation to apply for Indonesian citizenship before they reach 18 years old, then the government will grant the dual citizenship to these children born before 2006. So there is a special regulation for the children. Children means those who are under 18 years old that were born, who were born before 2006. So they could apply also dual citizenship too, but they have to fill in a special form. This is what I want to say. So I hope I could answer your question.
Thank you, Ibu Afifa. So the next question from Septantia, Universitas Brawijaya. A mixed couple that want to marry, if the bride or groom have dual nationality, does he or she shall fulfill the capacity requirement from both countries or allowed to pick just one? Thank you. So for someone who have dual nationality.
Is it for
me? Sorry, is it okay. For Afifa? I'm sorry.
All right, it's okay. A mixed couple that want to marry, if the bride or groom have dual nationality. Have dual nationality is only allowed if this individual below 18 years old, right? In Indonesia, you cannot have dual nationality when once you reach 18 years old. And then Indonesian Marriage Act only allows people to get married when reach the minimum of 19 years old. Means that this person no longer has dual nationality. Do you understand what I mean? The logic. So those who could get married only individual who already reach at least 19 years old. Okay? And the individuals who reach 19 years old no longer have dual nationality, because dual nationality could only be owned by those who are under 18 years old. So it's impossible somebody are married under Indonesian law are allowed to have dual nationality. If we are talking the mixed couple, is one of them is Indonesian citizen, because to get married, Indonesian citizen must reach 19 years old. And when you reach 19 years old, you have to choose. You cannot have dual nationality. So I think this is my answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Afifa. We still have 5 minutes remaining before the opening ceremony. So I go to the next question. This two question for Dr. Helmi. First question is there any family law from Malaysia that can be adopted in Indonesia? And you want to answer first, or I go to the second question?
Okay. For the first question, I'm not clear with the question.
Yeah. Is there any family law from Malaysia law that can be adopted in Indonesia? The principle from Malaysia, okay. Like, yeah. Adoption, legal adoption.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. For Indonesia, for Indonesia country, okay, to adopt Malaysian law, I think I don't know what are the mechanism, but you can learn from the best practice in Malaysia. Okay, especially in the family matters. Okay, we have the family support. Okay, we have the family support divisions. Okay. That enforce, okay, the judgment from the court regarding the maintenance. Okay, I believe in Indonesia, I don't know what are the mechanism they use to enforce, because we have the enforcement, but to enforce, okay, the judgment made by the judges, okay, we do have the one of the mechanism that we have, the division, family support division, okay, to enforce the judgment regarding the maintenance. I think that's one of the way that that Malaysia, that Indonesia can follow us, okay, Malaysia. Okay, I think I answering the questions.
Okay. Thank you. So the last question for Dr. Helmi. From Maheswari, is it possible to couple who are not register their marriage accordance with the Sharia and seek any remedy or recourse in the Sharia court? Thank you. Sorry.
Okay, it is impossible. Okay, to get a remedy. Okay, the first thing I mentioned in my lecture is for the Muslim, the first thing is the essential validity. Okay. The court, let me explain to you, okay, briefly. First, the court will determine whether, okay, that marriage is valid, okay, according to the Islamic law or not. If not, okay, the court will not recognize and the court will not order to register that marriage. Okay, that's why court will call first, okay, the parties of the marriage, okay, will examine, okay, whether the procedure, okay, has been followed by the parties. If the procedure has been followed by the parties, then the court will order that marriage to be registered. So there is a mechanism, but there has to follow certain procedures. Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Helmi. So, Ibu Dr. Afifa, this is the last question. I read like some similar question to this question regarding interfaith marriage, especially in Indonesia. As we know, until now, interfaith marriage still a debate in Indonesia. So the question from Saswan, Universiti Kebangsaan Malaysia, Mrs. Afifa. Greetings, Mrs. Afifa. I have a question. Is interfaith marriage is permissible in Indonesia? If it is permissible, what law will be used in dividing the inheritance when the parents pass away, as Islam has its own mechanism in dividing of inheritance called faraid? And if the interfaith marriage is not permissible, is there any sanction for the couple who married with different religion? Thank you.
Thank you for one question. I'm sorry if I wrongly pronounce your name. Yeah, it's a good question. Shazwan, yes. All right. So, is interfaith marriage is permissible in Indonesia? For legally, yes, it is. So I give you the base on this. Although it is not written in Indonesian Marriage Act expressly or explicitly, but it is written in the what it is called Population Administration Act. Population Administration Act, all right? So Article 35 of Population Administration Act mentioned that marriage that is ruled by the court is a marriage performed by an interfaith couple. Because if it is not interfaith, so the same religion, then you are married according to, or your marriage will be solemnized in accordance to the couple's religion by the religious officials that deals with the same religion belong to the couple. In the case of interfaith marriage, then the couple must get the ruling first from Indonesian court in the district where they reside or where they have residence. So it is allowed. Then your question would be, then what law will be used in dividing the inheritance? As I mentioned earlier, regarding the succession to property or inheritance, Indonesian private international law applies the nationality principle. It means that regarding the succession, then the national law of the death of the deceased will govern the succession. So for example, in the interfaith marriage, one spouse is Muslim, another is not Muslim, and happen who is dead is the Muslim, okay, regardless if it's mother or father. Then the succession of the property or the inheritance will be governed by the Islamic law. So the law of the dead that governs. If who passed away is the non-Muslim father or mother, then the succession issue will be governed by, I do not know, either the Christian or basically non-Islamic law regarding the inheritance. So mostly we will use the civil code that we inherited from the colonial law, colonial government. So this is the principle, all right? I hope I give you the clear answer. And then, and if the interfaith marriage is not permissible, is there any sanction? No, not at all. In Indonesia, we don't give any sanction. It is human right to get married according to, you know, their wishes, part of human right. And the Indonesian government try as much as possible to protect the marriage, as long as it complies with the formal requirements as well as substantive requirements of Indonesian law. So I hope I could answer you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Afifa Kusumadara, and also thank you, Dr. Muhammad Helmi. So this is the end of today's class. I believe there are a lot of things that still want to discuss with the speaker, but we only have limited time. Therefore, I kindly ask the speaker to please write down the email address in the chat box. So if the participant want to discuss more, they can email the speaker. Thank you to all the speakers for the excellent presentation, for all the knowledge. Thank you for all participants for the question, yeah, as well as to the committee for the hard work. Actually, today is public holiday in Indonesia, but everyone still keeps the spirit up. One again, thank you. So I will give the control back to our master, our beloved master ceremony, Ibu Mega Novita. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Ibu Ranitia Ganinda SHMH, Bapak Dr. Muhammad Helmi MD Said, and Ibu Afifa Kusumadara SHLLM SCD. It is very interesting discussion. Thank you very much. Everyone, let's give virtual applause for them by clicking the reaction below. Just do it like anything, love, thumbs up, or clap, or smile, or pop up celebration, it's okay. Thank you very much. Due to the limited time, my apologies, maybe we couldn't accommodate all of the questions here. If some of you still have questions or wondering about something, you can ask the speakers privately by email. Our speakers already wrote their email address. So save them. And then if you need it, maybe later, not today. So just write them email. Well, to officially end this joint class series, I would like to invite Ibu Afifa Kusumadara SHLLM SJD again to deliver her closing speech on behalf of Universitas Brawijaya. Please, Ibu Dr. Afifa, time is yours.
Thank you, Ibu Mega. Sorry to take a bit more time to give a closing speech. Thank you for your patience. All right. Now I will start. On behalf of the Dean of the Brawijaya Law Faculty, as the head of the Research and Cooperation Unit, formally close this program. I sincerely thank the Faculty Undang-Undang, Universiti Kebangsaan Malaysia, to participate in this program. I also extend my gratitude to all lecturers who take time to teach in this program. Also thanks to the students who joined this program from day one until today. Special thanks for both the UKM and Brawijaya organizing committees for their hard work. Without them, this program could not be accomplished. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. I hope that this program could continue in the future because I believe that it benefits all of us, especially the students of both universities. Thank you very much. Now I will return this session back to the Master of Ceremony. Thank you.
Thank you, Ibu Dr. Afifa. Next, I would like to invite Bapak Associate Professor Dr. Syahrul Mizan Ismail as the Deputy Dean of Networking and Income Generation to give the closing speech on behalf of Universiti Kebangsaan Malaysia UKM. Bapak Associate Professor Dr. Syahrul Mizan Ismail, are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready, Madam Chairperson. I'm here.
Okay. Thank you. So now time is yours.
I would like to seek your permission to allow me to share a few slides on the screen. May I?
Yeah, you can do it.
Right. Thank you very much. So thank you very much, Madam Chairperson. for the welcoming remarks. First and foremost, I would like to say when I first received the invitation to attend this program, I have to say I was very excited. I was really excited because Brawijaya is like an old friend, and I was really looking forward to attend the program. And when Dr. Siti Nurhafiza asked me and invited me to actually close the program, I was even more honored. So this is a great honor for me. So I just would like to share with you a few slides. This is my photo when I was in Brawijaya with all the students in the university. It was really a great time for me when I was there. I give a series of lectures on international human rights law, and I was working with Prischa. I'm not sure whether Prischa is here today. So I love your students very much. They were very, very active, and it really surprises me in the first few lectures. The lecturers were very receptive as well. I used lots of technology in my class, and they even invited me to share on e-learning. So this was the workshop that I delivered and shared my experience on using e-learning with the lecturers there. So first and foremost, I would like to say thank you very much to the organizing committees of both universities for organizing this program. I would like to share with you a quotation from Mr. Henry Ford. Basically says that coming together is a beginning. So I think we came together and had a memorandum of understanding between two universities. And as Henry Ford said, staying together is a progress, and we stayed together. The memorandum of understanding was actually renewed between two universities in 2019, right? So we have stayed together, so that's a progress. And now we are working together for this program, and it's a success. So I think the quotation is very much in line with what we are doing now. And for that, I think I would have to thank the organizing committees of both universities for organizing the three series of joint class online via Zoom. You can see we have covered so many things in just 3 days, and with so many lecturers sharing so many information. I think this is really great. This is a really great program. Yeah. And I think COVID-19 is actually a blessing in disguise. Don't you agree? It is actually a crisis, but somehow or other, it has drawn both universities closer to each other. If before this, if we want to be together, we would have to go to Indonesia or Brawijaya, you would have to come to UKM in Bangi. But now we just have to meet in Zoom. And we have met not only just for 1 day, but for 3 days. Not for one class, but 3 classes. So it has actually drawn both universities closer to each other. It has makes it more convenient for us to share more and grow together in a more convenient way. Now it's just online. And I think it has made us more creative, don't you think so? We even have our virtual backgrounds now. And Madam Chairperson is actually encouraging us to do a reaction whenever we want to share, clap for the speaker, so on and so forth, right? So I think all in all, COVID-19 is actually a blessing in disguise in the perspective of the relationship between the two universities. So for future collaboration between both universities, I would have to, I would like to call upon the head of MICOL, Malaysian Centre for Comparative Law of our Faculty of Law UKM, and the coordinator for the memorandum of understanding between Brawijaya and UKM, Dr. Siti Nurhafiza, to work further on more programs with Brawijaya. I think maybe what we can do after this is to work on a memorandum of association to strengthen the relationship between both universities. If possible, we would like to invite students from the Bachelor of Law program in Brawijaya to continue Masters of Law program in UKM. We have few collaboration programs with Malaysian universities on this, and this is the first, my first attempt to open this to an Indonesian university. So I would like to call upon Dr. Siti Nurhafiza and Dr. Rizal to try and do this with Brawijaya, and perhaps more research project after this. So on behalf of the Faculty of Law of National University of Malaysia, Universiti Kebangsaan Malaysia, and also our beloved Dean, Prof. Dr. Nazura Abdul Manap, I think she really wished so much that she could be here with us today. All right, I would like to thank the organizing committee of both universities, specifically Dr. Afifa Kusumadara and Dr. Rika Kurnianti and your organizing committee, of course. And for UKM, I would like to thank Associate Professor Dr. Rizal as the head of the Malaysian Center for Comparative Law for the Faculty of Law UKM, because this is actually under this center. And also to Dr. Siti Nurhafizah Azizan as the coordinator for the collaboration program. So last but not least, I have three pantun, because this is actually, because I think Indonesia and Malaysia share some sort of similarity in terms of cultural values, right? So I have three pantun here that I want to share. Anak unka terbang cepat, anak kedidi berjalan sedepa, bukan senang mencari sahabat, sahabat berbudi sukar dijumpa. Ya, pantun, my second pantun, ya, pantun kedua. Anak buaya naik mencuri, singgah mari di pasir panjang, hutang budi sukar dicari, kalau dapat kasih berpanjangan. Last but not least, anak merak kampung Cina, singgah berhenti kepala piti, emas perak kebesaran dunia, budi bahasa tak dapat dicari. Okay, with that, I would like to end my speech. Thank you very much.
Very nice. Thank you very much, Bapak Associate Professor Dr. Syahrul Nizan Ismail. Well, we are now moving to the final agenda, which is the photo session. I'll request to all of the participants to turn on the camera so that we can get good picture. As always, our operator will take snapshot of our picture. Here we still have 209 participants, but actually today's participants more than this. Yeah, more than 360, I think. Okay, here we have, oh, wait a moment. We have 9 screens. Yes, we have 9 screens. So you can say hi to the camera or thumbs up or give sarangi. Associate Professor Pak Syahrul Nizan Ismail, also you can say hi to the camera. Okay, still second screen, and then third screen, fourth screen, fifth screen, sixth screen, seventh screen, eighth screen, and then the final one. Okay, thank you. I think it is the end. Don't forget, I have some information for you all to fill in the attendance form to get the e-certificate, and anyone who wants to get the seminar materials can access the link sent in the chat room. As usual, write your name, write your address correctly, because if you made a mistake, then you will get trouble to get the e-certificate. If you have some problems to getting your email e-certificate, then you can contact us, our operator or the committee. Committee is also welcome for your questions or assistance for you to get the e-certificate safely. Then, ladies and gentlemen, we've reached the end of this joint class series. Me, myself, and all of the organizing committee, Faculty of Law Universitas Brawijaya, Faculty of Law University Kebangsaan Malaysia, very thank you for your very kind attention and cooperation. We will see you again in another event. Stay healthy, stay positive, and be happy. Once again, thank you very much. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. See you.
Tanah airku Indonesia, negeri elok amat ku cinta, tanah tumpah darahku yang mulia, yang ku puja sepanjang masa.